One of the best ways to level up quickly in Airtable is to get a really deep understanding of the different field types in Airtable. So really quickly, a field is a column inside of your grid database, and there are a bunch of different types of data that can live in those fields, and they get broken up into some very high-level categories. And understanding these and mastering these categories is going to really help you build smarter databases. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I'm the owner at Gap Consulting, where I help you save up to 20 hours every week using Airtable and other no-code tools. If that's of interest and you want to learn more about that, you definitely want to check out my free webinar training that's going to give you all the building blocks behind automation. This way you can leverage no-code automation and start implementing it in your daily life, in your daily work, so that you can start saving time. It has a big, profound impact on your overall productivity, so check it out at garethpronovost.com/webinar-registration. But without further ado, let's hop into the heart of this video where we're talking about Airtable's field types. At a high level, you should note that Airtable's field types can be broken down into two main categories. We have what I call independent fields and dependent fields. Namely, an independent field allows us to write data to it. A dependent field, by contrast, we can't actually write any information to that field. And that sounds a little weird. You might wonder why we even have those types of fields, but in fact, it's because they are deriving their value based on some sort of logic inside of the database. So either a formula that we've built, or somehow we're looking up data or aggregating data, and we're getting a value in that dependent field type. So there's a number of different independent and dependent fields. But before we jump into it, the important thing for you to know is that all fields can be broken down into one of these two buckets. And the really important thing for automation purposes, if you're writing data to a database, you can only ever do it to an independent field. As I said, by definition, a dependent field derives its value from some sort of logic. So with every automation you build, be sure to note which of your fields are independent, because you can only write data to those. And this is where a lot of newbies get tripped up, because they try to write data to a dependent field, but in fact, that dependent field doesn't derive its value from writing data directly to it. So let's go ahead and hop into my screen, and I'm going to go through some examples with you here. When you add a new field, you do it by hitting this plus button, and you get a long drop-down list of all the different field types. And you might notice that there's some of the more popular ones already at the top. So linking, putting in text, putting in long text, etc. As we scroll down, you're going to see some more complicated options. And in fact, a lot of those dependent fields are living down here at the end. Let me just pick one at random here. I'll pick a created time. What this field does is it's capturing metadata. It's going to tell us what the created time of a specific record is. We can opt to include a time field. We can opt to put it in Greenwich Mean Time or to display it in our local time. So yeah, we have some different filters or different formats that we can adjust here. But once we create this field, you're going to see that there are some date and times already stamped in there because these records have been in existence since the dates demonstrated here. But here's where you know, if you didn't already guess, that this is a dependent field. If I try to change this date, let's say I try to change it with any number, as soon as I start typing, I get this message here, and it tells me a created time field should be configured in the field menu dropdown. And this is the indication that this is a dependent field, meaning I cannot write data to it, and it's deriving its value based on the settings of the field itself. So this is dependent. If I were to try to write data to it from an automation, it would break. So let's explore some other options here. If I were to just enter in another field, we can go one by one, but the easier way for you to get a quick grasp on this is actually to check out my free PDF that I've already put together that has all of these things broken down. If you want to sign up, I'll include the link below this video, and you can just go ahead and grab it. Just pop your email address in. There's a double opt-in to make sure we're not spamming anybody. So once you confirm your email address from within your inbox, you'll then get instant access to the PDF. And it looks something like this. So jumping into here, I've denoted which of these are independent fields and which of them are dependent. But moreover, you'll notice that I've also gone in and told you which of these fields can be in the primary field. So again, if you're new to Airtable, the primary field is a very important field for every single database that we build. Moreover, within every table that we build, there's a new primary field. So if you're a little unsure about what I'm talking about, let's flip back into Airtable really quickly. And inside of here, you'll see that in my projects table in this particular example, my projects table is the one that's selected, and here I have the name field. The leftmost field in every single table is called the primary field. Now, what's so special about it? Well, it is the field that's going to tell us what lives in that record. So this table is projects, and it makes sense for me to give a title to every project that helps me identify what that project is. So you might think, for example, if I went with like an auto number field and I just marked all of these with a number, 1, 2, 3, that doesn't really tell me much about what this project is. It's a lot more beneficial to have some description in that primary field. And the reason for that is when I link to other tables, as I've done here, I've linked to tasks. You can see the name of those tasks, step 1, step 2. That name is derived from that primary field. So whatever we choose for that name field, that primary field, the leftmost field, that is what's going to show up in all the other areas of our database every time we have a linked relationship. The primary field is a really important field to master, and so you'll notice here I've got this link to my projects where I've got these tasks that pertain to project one. What the heck is project one? It's really not very helpful because I haven't put a lot of description in there. So let me go back to projects and I'll control Z, undo that. I want a descriptive name for this project. If I go back to tasks, you'll see that I now know exactly what project that is because I get that name pulled in. So here are my two tips for the primary field. I've said it before and I'm sure I'm going to say it again, but my number one tip for this is to make sure that it describes what lives in that table. If you don't put a good descriptor into that field, then it's not going to do you much good because when you've linked to other tables, you won't really know what you've linked to. Now, the other rule that I like to follow is I make it as unique as possible. It doesn't have to be perfectly unique, but I want it to be distinctive so that when I see it, it helps me understand what it is. Now, a lot of times I see, especially newbies, will start with, let's say, like a people table, and they think, well, email is always unique. Let me make email be the primary field. But it doesn't do much to describe what type of data lives in that people table. People, we don't think of them by email address. So I prefer to use a full name here because that is how I tend to think about people, first and last name. And the email field should not be the primary field, even though it is more unique than, let's say, full name, because let's face it, we probably all know a couple John Smiths. The truth is, Airtable records actually have their own unique record ID that lives beneath the surface that you and I don't even see. We only see this if we call upon that ID using a formula. In fact, everything that we do with automation, we always know exactly what this is, and Zapier, Integromat, Airtable automations, they know what that record ID is because that data is passed to those automation tools. But if you want to see it, well, you have to create that field using this particular formula, record underscore ID, open close parentheses, and when you do that, you'll get to see what that unique identifier is. But back to field types, the important thing to note here, if I were to flip back to my handout, is that some fields can be used in the primary fields, but not all. In fact, there are many different types of fields that we can't even put into that primary field, and there are some good reasons behind that. For example, using a lookup field or using a rollup field in the primary field makes zero sense at all. But you can use those fields that are denoted here at the top, but then important to notice is that, yes, not all of those are independent. The auto number field doesn't really usually make the best primary field, and it is a dependent field. Formulas are definitely a field that I use in my primary field a lot because it helps me follow my two rules, keeps it really unique, and it also identifies what lives there if you write a good formula. So what are the different options before you, and why would you want to use one field type over another? Well, the fact of the matter is, if you want to perform any kind of logic, mathematical or otherwise, inside of your database, you're going to need the right field type in order to write the formulas and whatnot in order to deliver the results you need. For example, if you had quantity and price, and you tried to multiply those things, but you were using text fields, it's probably going to break your formula to get the total, right? Quantity times price equals total. But if you don't use a number field or a currency field, it doesn't really matter. Let me jump into my database and show you exactly what I mean here. If I were to go with price, just imagine that I had a price here and I used a currency field. Great. I can build this price at $100. No problem. And then I build a quantity here and I would use a number field for that. And again, this is another independent field type. I would set it to take an integer. And let's say I had a quantity of 2. So if I had a total, we both know that the total would be 200. 100 times 2. So I would simply say price times quantity, just like this. I would output that so I can change the formatting to be whatever type of data I want. I'd output it as a currency and I'd create the field. And there we go. We see that that price total is 200. But if I made this a different type of field, if this was a single line text field, well, what happens? My formula errors out because 100, even though it looks like $100 here, is text. And so Airtable doesn't know how to think about it properly. The important part to note is that whenever you're using an independent field, you use the right type of field to make sure you get the right results. Otherwise, your data isn't going to pull through your database properly. Now, there are some other advantages as well to using the right type of data field. For example, if you had an email field here and you wanted to just open up an email, I can go ahead and pop in my own email address. And if I were to click on this field, it will actually open up an email already prepped and ready to send to that email address. That's a big advantage to using the right type of field, going to save you a lot of time on the back end. So again, the important takeaways here, especially if you're new to Airtable, is memorize those dependent field types. This is going to take some time. You're going to have to explore and experiment with them. And if you're ever in question about if a field is dependent or otherwise, know that you cannot write data directly to a dependent field. The only way to get a dependent field to change is to reconstruct the field configuration. An independent field, by contrast, you will be able to enter data right to it, just as I did here, just as I did here, and just as I did here. But if I wanted to try to change this total by typing, I get that message that says formula field should be configured in the field menu dropdown, which means this is obviously a dependent field. Again, I invite you to check out the PDF handout that I have included for this particular video. Check the links below if you want to get access to that, and I will see you in the next video.
As always, I hope you found that to be extremely helpful. If you did and you'd like to learn more, swing by our website and see how we can help. We offer a free Airtable crash course that will help you level up in Airtable quickly, and we also have some paid services, including hourly consultations with our experts. We have some online courses and a group coaching program. And for advanced needs, we can build a bespoke solution for you from scratch. So swing on by, and I look forward to connecting with you soon.